Muncher.
It's almost here.
2 years we've been waiting.
Almost here.
2 years have led to this. 6 hours to go. How am I going to sleep?
You're not going to sleep?
Yeah, but we're in India, so we have to watch it at 6:30 a.m. And we expected to sleep before that. That is ridiculous. That is a ridiculous proposition.
You're not expected to sleep before that. And you should not sleep before that. I'm so pumped, dude. They took a while for this stuff. But I hope it's going to be great, man.
Well, you know what? I'll be honest. Season 7, I think, jumped the dragon a little bit in certain points. We've all discussed it to death. Some time jumps, some fast ravens.
Geography is thrown out of the window now.
Yeah. There's a time-space vortex in the middle of King's Landing that allows people to travel in portals, I guess.
Dude, screw all of that. Are you ready for 6 big-budget Hollywood movies weekly getting released?
It's going to be insane. I'm so pumped that we're doing a screening because I want to watch this on as big a screen as possible with as good sound as possible and with as many people as possible. This is the perfect setting.
I cannot wait, man. 6 hours to go, dude. I literally cannot wait. Why don't we talk about where season 7 left us?
Season 7 left us high and dry with an ice dragon taking down the wall and a slap in the face of a 2-year wait. And now it's 2 years later. My life's the same. I haven't moved ahead in life at all.
I'm sure Game of Thrones has absolutely nothing to do with that.
I don't know, man. Maybe if season 8 came out earlier, my life would have moved forward. I just kept waiting.
Just stop blaming Game of Thrones for your personal issues.
With bated dragon breath. All right, let's do it. Let's just break down where we're at. So I actually think the most interesting part is what happened with Jaime and Cersei. Like, it's not talked about enough. That was a big, big, big moment for Jaime.
Exactly.
He said, like, I love Cersei. I'm going to die with Cersei. I live with Cersei and I'm going to die with Cersei.
And that's all he did for like 6.5 seasons, basically.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
And I think that lends a lot of credit to the fact that Jaime might kill Cersei. We can talk about that later. But that's where we left off. Jaime is traveling to Winterfell to keep his oath.
That's true. And also, I think he's just had a personal realization that, like, we all thought at different points in the series that Cersei was just off the deep end. But
dude, when she said kill Jaime to the mountain,
yeah,
I actually wanted it to happen because that would have been the ultimate culmination of Cersei being off the deep end. Sadly, she still has some like love for Jaime left, it seems.
It seems, but then basis of last season as well, now you truly feel that she's off the deep end because she realizes what potential threat the world faces, not just King's Landing or this kingdom or that kingdom, but just the world in general, and she's still oblivious to it. And I think Jaime realizes that and he's, peace, I'm out. I can't take it anymore, right? And he has an oath. He's still shown to be this loyal sort of... guy who's on the right side of things, essentially, even though his character initially in the series wasn't. And
He had sex with his sister and killed a child in the pilot episode. Yeah. And here we are rooting for him.
So his character has grown pretty interesting over the season. So yeah, in terms of where King's Landing is or what's happening in King's Landing, Cersei's still there. She's still this inner silo. I'm going to protect myself and my kingdom.
So what do you think happens then? In the first episode and the rest of the season with King's Landing?
Not sure, man, because these guys haven't released the episode titles yet. All I know or what we're meant to think is that the first episode is going to be very Winterfell focused. I'm sure there'll be Cersei scenes here and there, but I think the action side of things in this episode is going to be at Winterfell, which is basically Jon and Daenerys are on their way to Winterfell. The Starks are already there.
We know that the Battle of Winterfell is 60 minutes on tape or 55 minutes. The longest battle ever filmed for film or movies.
Most expensive.
Most expensive. All at night. It's like Helm's Deep's uncle, basically, when it comes to everything. So that's not going to be the first episode, of course. So probably a lot of lead up to the Battle of Winterfell.
Possibly. Or, you know, the way they sort of set it up, right? They released that trailer, for example, the Winterfell teaser, essentially, where they showed literally... the entire castle destroyed, Jon's sword here, Arya's sword there, Bran's wheelchair all smashed up. I have a feeling that it won't be as straightforward as that. They're probably just going to do a switcheroo here or there, you know, like take the action off of Winterfell. And I think the Winterfell part is just going to be very deeply talking about Dany and Jon and the Starks meeting and then Dany and Jon finding about Jon's true lineage.
Whoa, we're jumping ahead. That's definitely going to happen. Do you think it'll happen in the first episode? I have my doubts there. But since we moved on to Winterfell, Why don't we summarize what the hell is going on there? And Winterfell is the heart of the action right now.
I mean, so presumably the White Walkers are on their way and their army of the dead is on their way to Winterfell. Again, given that these guys just toss geography out of the window, they're probably going to be there in a scene or two. And at Winterfell...
Those guys have a dragon. They can move fast.
Well, not the rest of them, right? Not the 100,000 people who are walking or dead people who are walking.
But you can tell them the shortest way to take, right? They don't care. They don't have any restrictions about taking the road paved. It's literally as the dragon flies, they can reach.
Dude, I mean, basis of the last season when these guys were beyond the wall, Gendry left these guys, reached the Night's Watch of a crow flew from Night's Watch, went to Dragonstone, and Dany got on a dragon and reached where these guys were beyond the wall. Listen, in two scenes.
Let me just pause you there. We don't talk about beyond the wall. All right? It's season 8. We waited 2 years.
There's no more beyond the wall.
Let's not pinpoint. There is, by the way, actually, because George Martin mentioned how... I'm forgetting where this came from, but I'm pretty sure he mentioned that the series and the show will go norther than they've ever gone before.
Interesting.
So there's going to be some reveal of maybe where the Night King comes from.
That I'm sure that's about the Land of Always Winter.
Okay, so I don't read the book. So
Land of Always Winter is basically whatever they've shown in the show about Beyond the Wall, right? There's they talk about the Tens in the show. So Tens are the northernmost clan, essentially. And beyond that, there's like a huge sort of...
And Antarctica.
And Antarctica is separated by like big mountains. And beyond that is the Land of Always Winter, quote unquote. And that's where the Night King and the White Walkers and all have been laying low these past 10,000 years, essentially. So norther than anything essentially means there's nothing norther than that. So I'm assuming it's going to be something about the Land of Always Winter.
But the Long Night has to refer to something happening in Westeros, right?
Yeah.
Do you think they'll go to Essos at all? There's no point anymore.
Or, you know, just outside of Westeros, they might, like Volantis or something, because Melisandre was going there in the middle of the last season.
But didn't she say she's going to die in Westeros at Dragonstone, her and Varys?
And also earlier in the show, they showed the other Red Priestess, the one who's senior most Red Priestess, and she was talking to Varys as well. And she had a lot of things to say that could tie into the season 8 premiere. So I think they'll go off of Westeros for sure.
The one who knew what Varys heard in the fire. I want to know so bad.
And Varys' expression when she was telling him all of that.
I know, it's crazy. Yeah. If Melisandre is like 300 years old, how old do you think that senior Red Priestess is?
I have no idea, man. I have no idea. But
what do you think she looks like without a necklace?
There's just so many things you need to find out. You like the small stuff, man. I'm so excited.
Yeah, so we've gotten diverted here. So Winterfell.
Mm-hmm.
Firstly, Jon and Arya reunion. Episode 1 has to be. That's like the easiest one.
Yeah.
Oh my God, I can't wait.
And then Jon and Bran as well. And then Bran just being like I'm not Bran anymore.
I can't wait.
Yeah.
I can't wait. Goosebumps.
I can't wait to see what Sansa and Arya's reaction to Dany's going to be as well.
Well, it could be like, oh, who's this bitch, you know? Or it could be, actually, you know what? I think Sansa and Arya will be like a little trepidatious.
Mm-hmm.
And then Bran will be like, oh, what's up, auntie?
What's up, aunt? But I think Arya and Sansa still don't know. It's just Sam and Bran, right?
Who? Yeah, I'm just picturing a whole scene now. Like the interplay is like, oh, and then Jon looks at it. What do you mean, aunt?
Who do you sing?
Who's that? Is that Hodor?
I thought that was Jon. That's my best Jon.
I don't have a Jon, but I did my best. I think if anybody will be accepting of Arya, it's Jon. Like who she's become. You know, like Sansa got freaked out.
What about Bran's acceptance, man? Like, Sansa still doesn't understand what she's dealing with.
Bran accepts and rejects everything.
No, what about the other people interacting with him thinking he's still Bran Stark, but he's not?
Oh, yeah.
Like,
yeah.
So what will Jon think? What will everyone else?
Dude, Jon will probably try to hug Bran, and Bran will be like...
Cold.
Yeah, he'll just be like, you know nothing, Jon Snow.
Dude, you know one character I think will show up in this season and hasn't yet, because we talk about the North, is Howland Reed. Jojen and Mira's dad.
Yeah.
So
he's still just lurking around somewhere.
He's still lurking around. And I personally feel he's lurking around because Ned Stark told him not to sort of surface and just lay low, because he's the only other guy apart from Ned Stark who knew of Jon's parents, right? Because he was there at the Tower of Joy. He survived. So he presumably knows. And he hasn't showed up the entire time. The only mention in the show, for example, is Jojen telling Bran that, you know, when I told my dad about your dad's death, he just started weeping. And that's all they've said.
There's a lot of characters that I want to see. And again, not even those who are in the books and not in the show. I mean, characters that are mentioned in the show and haven't been depicted visually. I'm just holding out. I know it's not going to happen, but I'm holding out. You know, they showed a small flashback of the Mad King.
Yeah.
I want to see the Mad King burn Brandon and Rickard Stark.
Yeah.
That'd be so good, dude.
That'd be good. And then, you know, other characters that just are on the side, so like Jaqen H'ghar. for example.
Oh, you think it'll play a role?
I think so, man.
I think it's done. That's done.
Yeah?
Unless they want like some deus ex machina.
Because there are like so many theories about who Jaqen H'ghar is or was. And one of the predominant ones is that he was Arya's sword fighting teacher.
No, that's a lame one. I don't like that one. Yeah, that's a dumb theory. And by the way, his name is Sirio Forel.
Sirio Forel,
he has one of the best lines in the show. Not one of the best lines from the book, I guess. There's only one god and his name is Death.
Almost word to word mimics that line.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Except he just says we call it the many-faced god.
Yeah, but that's just Bravo's philosophy, isn't it?
Probably right. But the Night King, man. We know nothing about the Night King.
So that's a show-only character, firstly, right? It's sort of just a personification of the others.
Also, because where the books have reached up until now, it's only the fifth book out. There's literally next to nothing in terms of talking about White Walkers and
So you know the Night King, the guy who plays the Night King, he kind of let his mouth run a little bit.
Oh yeah, what'd he say?
He said something along the lines of that the Night King has a target. Like,
I knew it.
Well, I'm not confirming it. It's still, who knows?
Maybe. But he said that. He said those exact words.
Yeah.
I think that's Jon Snow.
That's Jon Snow too, because, listen, I'm getting into spoiler territory here, but who cares? 6 hours to go.
Yeah.
He said that him and Jon Snow are going to have another face-off, which, let's face it, we all knew.
Mm-hmm.
And he said it's going to be more intense than Hardhome. So the fact, like the way the Night King looks at Jon Snow in Hardhome.
He doesn't kill him, right? He has so many chances of killing him.
Yeah, and beyond the wall as well. So clearly Jon Snow is a target. So what does that mean? Does the Night King want Jon Snow to be the next Night King?
I feel like it's like a replacement swap sort of situation, because the predominant theory in terms of the Night King is that he's a Stark or of Stark descent. So what's going around is that all of the White Walkers, not the dead people, but the White Walkers are basically Stark babies or of Stark lineage. And something along the lines of his time is up and that the replacement is needed. So Jon Snow is the only viable option for that.
But what about Bran as a target, man? Because the Night King is essentially like a super warg, isn't he? That's what he's doing with the zombies and the dragon. He's just warging into the dead. It does seem like warging. And Bran is so clearly the counterpart. Also, there's something to the fact that I think Bran was told, like, this is his destiny. Like, he needs to be there to, like, see the Night King or deal with the Night King. That's why he became the Three-Eyed Raven. I think there's going to be something to it. Also, there's this weird thing where Bran hands Arya the Catpaw's dagger.
Mm-hmm.
And the way he looks at it, it's like the reason he gives it, it needs to play a role. Because why did he make a big deal? And he just has this expression. And I saw a theory on another channel, which I love, which was that's like the dagger that's going to be used to kill him at some point. Like the way he was looking at it, he knew he was giving his own death to Arya. Like that's the craziest shit out there. Like Arya killing Bran because he's walked into some dragon and his killing him kills the dragon and the White Walkers. Yeah. Oh my God, dude, it's going to be awesome.
The knife definitely has something to play. And you know, I had this belief before one of the dragons turned was that Danny's going to ride a dragon, Jon's going to ride a dragon,
and Bran's
going to walk.
Oh, you're a Bran guy.
I'm a Bran guy. Dude, that role is so complex and there's so many different directions you can take that we literally don't know what they come up with.
I always thought it was going to be Tyrion because of the scene. Well, firstly, the Tyrion as a Targaryen theory is awesome.
Why is that theory viable?
Because apparently the Mad King got so mad at Tywin Lannister and he used to like just have a thing for Tywin Lannister's wife. And then at one point in the show, Tywin Lannister tells Tyrion Lannister in one of his like dwarf tirades that, oh, I just have to deal with you because I can't prove that you're not mine.
Right.
And you think that he's saying it because he's a dwarf, but actually it seems like Tywin Lannister just simply doesn't believe that he's his son. And then in the books, you'd know this, like Tyrion actually looks weirder, right?
Yeah,
so like
much
the Targaryen
weirder.
Hair and eyes and all that. I mean, if Tyrion is not a Targaryen, that dragon scene with Tyrion is some real fan service mind Easter egg business.
Which these guys do a lot.
Do they?
Yeah, they do.
Man, that one seems so on the nose. I was so convinced. So,
especially like the stuff that seems on the nose is most likely never true, right? They actually take a lot of effort in inculcating that within the show. But I would love to see Tyrion coming out as a Targaryen for sure.
So Jon, I guess, is almost a given. I mean, we can talk about that later as well. What else is happening in Winterfell? Sansa? Do we care about Sansa?
I guess a little bit. She's been through shit. I feel like her acceptance of Daenerys is going to be very just like full of friction, right?
You only care about the soap opera stuff. I'm talking about the fact that she doesn't she have the Knights of the Vale under her command?
Technically, no. Jon does.
Oh, he does?
Yeah.
Oh, because they're part of the North?
Yeah.
Ah,
they're aligned with the North as well because of their mom, right?
Yeah, but she's in charge of the North right now as well.
she's the lady in Winterfell.
Oh, only until Jon is back.
Yeah, only until Jon is back.
Hmm.
But like, you don't understand, dude. The Starks, historically, right? The only Stark who bent his knee to Aegon the Conqueror was literally hated. He was hated because up until that, they're just like fierce warriors, loyalists. So in terms of bending their knee to any other king or proclaiming someone else their ruler is a big no-no within the Stark territory.
So then it's not so much Daenerys as also Sansa's reaction and the North's reaction to Jon.
Yeah.
Why did Jon do it anyway?
It was kind of loose in terms of how quickly he turned.
Really
I didn't appreciate that much, but I guess they just need to accelerate the storyline to get it to where it is.
I think he just wanted that action, bro. Just wanted to close. I don't think he was thinking with his knifed heart there, if you know what I mean.
Oh, yeah, I do. But it's going to be fun to see how that pans out, right? Because first it's going to be, oh my God, who's this queen? And then, oh my God, she's not the queen, he's the king. And oh my God, he's not our brother. So all of that entire dynamic within Sansa,
Cousin John,
yeah.
It's like a character from Robin Hood.
And he's not a bastard anymore. He's actually a legitimate child. So between John, Arya, and Sansa, and maybe Bran if he wants to participate, that's going to be an interesting dynamic. I'm pretty sure it's going to unfold in the first episode.
What worries me about this season is the plot armor. I mean, Daenerys, firstly. Daenerys' plot armor is thicker than an Instagram model.
Oh, okay.
And Jon's plot armor has been really thick since he came back to life. And that is just not Game of Thrones proper, like we were used to. But season 7 changed that anyway. How much plot armor do you think other main characters like Jaime and Cersei have? They're going to be killing some characters willy-nilly. That's definitely...
They must.
They must, you know. Like the Davoses and the Theons of the world.
Not just that. I'm sure a few of the main people are just going to...
But that's what I mean. How thick is the plot armor on a Cersei or a Jaime as it relates to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 episodes?
See, Cersei, in terms of trying to predict based off the history of the show, Cersei would... Like, we can easily see her just getting offed.
But
that's never gone with the narrative of the show. The person you feel like is stable and is not going to die is the guy who dies or the girl who dies the first.
You know what? It's not just that. It's a little meta too. Because obviously the show in a meta way screwed with expectations from early on Ned Stark and the Red Wedding. But Cersei just has too much character building. She is the strongest character of the show. And she's actually the most unchanged. You know, so she needs something to happen before things change. Which brings me to Cersei's impending child. I can't believe we didn't talk about that.
You know, there are rumors out there that she's actually not pregnant.
Yeah. A lot of theories there. And what is going to be the time? You know, are we going to cover 9 months? We can't. There's no time. So a kid in the picture is actually never going to happen anyway.
Yeah, maybe it could sort of work itself into some sort of foreshadowing that show's ended and this is what Westeros is going to look like.
Hmm.
I just don't understand what her sort of plan is. I mean, sure, Euron's going to get the Golden Company. They'll have a massive fleet and a massive army, but to protect what? I feel like her plan is just to fuck up the Northerners and the Westeros sort of kingdoms.
Yeah, wait, what would you do in her situation? I actually kind of empathized with her planning at the end of season 7 because what is Daenerys asking of her? Help me out first and then so I can usurp you and maybe not kill you if you help me, I guess. And that is not Cersei's way at all. The big question is, do they win or lose the Battle of Winterfell? And from a story arc perspective, if the Battle of Winterfell happens in episode 3 or 4, they kind of have to lose, right? Game of Thrones is not like any other story, but that's sort of like the midway point where you lose and you retreat. Then what do they have to do? They have to head back south. And that's when Cersei holds the cards.
Till when? Assuming that's the whole thing, right? Like they'll keep funneling in towards the south and eventually get to King's Landing. Geography disregarded, obviously. So they get to King's Landing. And then what's Cersei's plan? Like she'll eventually have to either join them or defend herself. There's no other way.
Well, she has a dragon killing spear, supposedly.
Right. And she has wildfire, which she's super proud about.
Yeah, she's actually pretty well equipped, dude, with the Golden Company and...
And you know, one thing that's not mentioned in the show at all is that she's completely unprotected from the south. We haven't seen what happened with Dawn or what the end result is because all the main characters died. But that's a huge kingdom on the south, like just below King's Landing, which is Like, we don't know what the situation is there. So I'm sure there'll be something in season 8.
I don't think they'll bring it up again.
Yeah?
Dude, there's too much time. There's too much happening.
I'm telling you, 6 Bollywood blockbusters, one after the other, every Sunday.
How dare you say Bollywood?
Oh, I'm sorry, 6 Hollywood blockbusters, one after the other, every Sunday.
I hope it's not like Bollywood. I really do. It's getting there with season 7, but I really hope it's not.
I hear you on Daenerys' plan of truce instead of... I think she should have just asked her for help. Like, join us rather than...
She did ask for help, but she can't say join us. Like, Daenerys is born to be the queen of the Seven Kingdoms.
Yeah, man. She also has that curse going for her. Like, one prophecy still has to come true.
So what were the other two betrayals? Jorah Mormont was one?
Yeah. And the witch?
Oh, the one who killed Khal Drogo?
Yeah.
Ah. So who do you think the third one is?
I mean, it sort of says one by love. So probably Jon?
No, I think it has to be Tyrion. I think one by love, Jon being is too obvious. It's probably Tyrion. He's actually not had much to do in the past couple of seasons.
He's an advisor.
He did the back channeling with Cersei.
Mm-hmm.
And now with the last scene of season 7, him onlooking Jon and Daenerys engaging in
mating.
Incest mating. Hey, what do you make of that look, by the way?
I don't know, man. It's tough to say what these guys are thinking, especially with the way the show's gone. It could be a bunch of things.
But what's he worried about? He definitely looked worried. He's not in love with Daenerys, right?
Could be.
Everybody seems to be in love with Daenerys.
Yeah.
Okay, but let's assume that's not the case. He's very pragmatic. Like, Daenerys and him have been discussing succession, and she just disregards it every time so far. He probably... What did he offer to Cersei to do the back channeling and mediation? I'm sensing that Jon and Daenerys being together, the possibility of an heir, you know, somehow screw something up, right? They want to break the wheel, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what he seemed worried about to me.
Also, just given how Varys and Tyrion's characters have been throughout the show, do you think they know of Jon's true identity?
No chance. Varys, no way. I mean, because Varys is the biggest Targaryen supporter there is, at least within the show. So if he knew, he would be propping up Jon. He would be supporting Jon, not Daenerys. Not only would he have the true claim to the throne, Jon, but Varys would imagine a better world under Jon than even Daenerys. And that's supposedly what he wants. I know in the books, it's unclear what he wants. In the show, he spells out that's what he wants. So
in the books too, he's a pretty heavy Targaryen supporter. Yeah, I guess you're right. Yeah, they probably don't know.
Yeah, they don't know. It's going to be a shock to them too, actually. And actually, I look forward to Tyrion's reaction as well.
Yeah.
To me, that's the easiest thing to do in episode 1.
And then the Knight's army is obviously destroying some parts of the North, so you got action there.
I can't wait to it. It's going to be so good. The Knight's army, firstly, it really annoyed me because their dragon wings have holes in them. And, you know, you can't fly like that. But anyway.
Physics? You bring physics into this?
Magic physics.
They have a magic wall, man.
But they can't rush it too, right? The ending, yes, it made sense to have season 7 end with that badass moment. But now they can't just rush it. How far is the wall from Winterfell anyway?
It's actually pretty far, but I mean, you can't talk about how long it's going to take or how long it's not going to take because the show really let go of that stuff last season.
So much of the trailers focus on the crypts of Winterfell.
Yeah.
And so I'm guessing a lot of that happens in episode 1 as well.
There's some magic wolf blood thingamajig happening with the Stark family, man, for sure, which is going to come out in this season.
In the show, because I know it's true in the books that that's the case.
No, the books is like very wolf blood walking and all of that stuff, but there's some sort of heavier magical element. Bran the Builder, you know, like there's so much history there that it's going to surface for sure, man.
I've heard this theory. Do you think magic ends at the end of the show?
I don't know, because...
In the realm?
Yeah, because they keep talking a lot about how magic is directly correlated with dragons. So, like, whenever the last dragon sort of faded away, magic faded away as well. So, mm-hmm. I guess it depends on sort of what happens to the dragons.
And Samwell Tarly, do you think he fights?
I think he fights, like, in the castle. So, he's not on the front line, like, fighting the armies. But I'm sure the castle's going to be infiltrated at some point and he's going to use his dragonglass experience.
I'm looking forward to Samwell Tarly using Heartsbane and killing a second White Walker.
Dude, I hope he gives that sword to someone more qualified than him, man.
No, that's not how heroism works, man. Come on.
Oh, God.
He's going to protect Gilly, man.
Yeah, I guess he has to. Also, dude, like, Gilly and her child, because he's the child is Craster's child, essentially, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Craster had this big thing going of sacrificing his children for the White Walkers.
Mm-hmm.
There's something there, too. I'm not sure what it could be.
I have to say, though, if we just take every strand where something could be there and set up expectations for ourselves, it's a recipe for disaster. They only have six
episodes.
It's
already done, dude.
Dude, George Martin couldn't even write and, like, you know, just click off everything he's clicked on in terms of plot threads. So there's no way the showrunners are going to be able to do that. And I don't blame them.
But you have to have these high expectations. That's what the show set itself up for. So obviously, man, there's so many open-ended questions. There's so many open-ended theories that the show itself created because of its, like, scenes or lines here and there. And almost always they do come back to it. So because this is the culmination of the show, they literally have to tie up as much as they can.
Yeah, well, cheers to them, man. I hope they do. I can't wait. I don't even know what to do for the next 5-6 hours. Like, more Game of Thrones will just blow my head, and, like, I'll keep thinking about these theories, and not watching Game of Thrones just seems like a waste.
I'm going to do some coffee and meditation, dude. That's my next 5 hours.
Oh, man, I hope I don't need to do that after the episode, because... 2 years, man. 2 years.
Don't jinx it. No jinx.
Let's go. Let's go do this. Any parting thoughts?
You know, I'm just going to work on setting up the screening at the office and just try to keep my mind off of Game of Thrones as much as possible. Because otherwise, I'm just going to keep raising the bar in my head. And I know I agree with you. That's just
nothing,
setting myself off for disaster. Yeah.
There was a time when the show would live up to whatever bar, but they took the bar up and then they started dropping it. Let's just play it safe.
They're just swinging the bar widely now. So you don't even know what's going to hit, what's going to miss.
Dude, you know the worst part? The damn cast keeps saying how good the ending is. And I'm just like, why did you say that?
But that's their job. That's their job. Even if it's not, they have to say that.
You think so?
Yeah, I'm not going to buy too much into that.
All of them saying it?
Yeah, obviously. Come on.
Fair enough.
The last season of the best show or the biggest show ever made. So
this decade, for sure.
So they're never going to come out and be like, or just downplay the ending or anything like that, right? I mean, yeah, it's okay. Yeah, okay.
All right, man. Let's go. Let's do this. 6 hours to go.
Yeah, man. Let's do this. So pumped. You're going to explode, bro. Chill out.